Now, I'd like to introduce our panelists for today. First, I'd like to introduce Neil Barsky. Neil is the founder and chairman of the Marshall Project. He has been a newspaper reporter for the Wall Street Journal and the New York Daily News, an equity research analyst at Morgan Stanley, a hedge fund manager at Midtown Capital and Alston Capital, and the film director of the documentary Coke. That's K-O-C-H. Mr. Barsky is also the chairman of the Columbia Journalism Review Board of Advisors, and he sits on the board of trustees of Oberlin College. He published a critical piece in the New York Times this summer that galvanized forces describing how a Rikers Island shutdown could actually work in practice. And we thank you for that. Neil Barsky, come on up. Martin Horn is a distinguished lecturer at John Jay College of Criminal Justice. For nearly 7 years prior to joining the faculty in September 2009, he served simultaneously as correction commissioner and probation commissioner for the city of New York. He previously served as secretary of corrections for the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, and for many years was the executive director of New York State's paroling authority. Mr. Horn has over 40 years' experience working in corrections and community supervision. He's been a warden and has taught, written, and spoken about issues of prison and parole reform throughout his career, not just at the very end of it. Thank you for that. Come on up, Professor. Khary Lazarre-White is a social entrepreneur, educator, nonprofit executive, writer, and attorney. In 1995, he co-founded the Brotherhood Sisterhood SOL, a nationally renowned youth development and educational organization that provides a host of community organizing services, such as school care, after-school care, counseling, summer camps, job training, college prep and scholarship, employment opportunities, community organizing training, legal representation, and international study programs. You can start your own college with that variety of coursework. Mr. Lazarre-White has extensive experience as a public speaker across the country, writes regular opinion pieces for the Huffington Post, and essays for publications including NYU Press, Nation Books, and MSNBC.com. He received his bachelor's in arts from Brown University and his law degree from Yale Law School. Come on up. Thank you. Anne Marie Louison joined CASES in 1999 and is the co-founder of the Nathaniel Project, the first alternative to incarceration program in Manhattan Supreme Court for adults with severe and persistent mental illness convicted of felony offenses. Ms. Louison became director of mental health programs in 2002, overseeing Nathaniel Act and subsequently launching the exit and transitional case management programs. In 2001, CASES merged its criminal court and mental health programs into a new program group, Adult Behavioral Health, which Ms. Louison currently leads. She's also a consultant to the Council of State Governments Justice Center and is regularly selected to attend national expert panel discussions on jail diversion. Come on up, Anne Marie. Charles Nuñez is the community advocate at Youth Represent, where he plays a key role in the organization's policy reform work and community partnerships. Alongside representatives from the Correctional Association and Center for Community Alternatives, he leads the Youth Speakers Institute, a youth leadership program dedicated to training and connecting young people who have been directly impacted by our criminal justice system to participate in advocacy, public education, and justice reform opportunities. He aspires to continue his studies within the legal field and practice law in the public interest sector. Charles, come on up. Carmen Perez is executive director of the Gathering for Justice. She has crossed the globe promoting peace, advancing human and civil rights, and building alternatives to incarceration and violence while collaborating in national policy presentations. She provides support to individuals incarcerated in juvenile detention centers and California's and New York's prisons. In November 2013, she founded Justice League NYC, a task force of juvenile and criminal justice advocates, experts, artists, and formerly incarcerated individuals. Ms. Perez has gained respect as an expert in the field of juvenile and criminal justice and has appeared on CNN, MSNBC, New York One, CNBC, CBS, and has been featured in articles in the New York Times, Washington Post, Wall Street Journal, and many more. Carmen? We expected to have Liz Glazer with us, the Director of Criminal Justice Initiatives in the Mayor's Office. Unfortunately, she canceled and was not able to, the Mayor's Office was unable to send a representative. And we apologize for that. It was a very recent cancellation. Finally, today's panel will be moderated by the one and only Errol Louis. Errol joined New York One as the host of Inside City Hall in November 2010. Prior to joining New York One, he was a daily news columnist, writing on a range of political and social affairs and serving on the paper's editorial board. In addition to his New York One work, Louis is a frequent guest on other TV and radio programs. He's been a CNN contributor since 2008, when he provided expert commentary at key points throughout the presidential campaign. He holds a bachelor's degree in government from Harvard University, a master's in political science from Yale, and a law degree from Brooklyn Law School. And we are so lucky to have him and all the panelists here today. A round of applause for everyone.
Thank you. Yes. Okay. Thank you, Jeff. And welcome to everybody. We're going to have a spirited and informative discussion, and you're going to be invited to join us toward the end. So the general, time outlook is for about 90 minutes we're going to talk. And I'm going to slip off at the end of that time because I got to go do my show tonight. We're going to also have, as I said, an opportunity for you to sort of weigh in. This is being streamed, as I understand. And there's a hashtag that will flash up on the screen and will tell you if you feel like tweeting what you want to say. I'm going to ask the panelists to sort of put aside the various titles that you have. As you heard from those extensive introductions, everybody's got kind of a lot of different things going on. You know, Khary has been doing youth work and building an institution here in the city, but he also has a law degree. Martin Horn, as you heard, is doing academic work, but has extensive experience in government, Neil Barsky in finance, and on and on and on. I'll ask people, let's just talk. And we'll have a conversation that I will lead, but really, if you have something to say, please just jump in. If it gets a little disorderly, I may intervene, but other than that, I would like to just make sure we touch on some important points. And I wanna start with Commissioner Horn. When I first met Martin Horn, he wanted me to come in. I was at the Daily News at the time, and I came in to interview him, and the first thing he said is, we need to close down Rikers Island. And this was years ago. And he showed me hurricane maps that, you know, on a very practical level, if a Category 3 ever hit New York Harbor, a big chunk of the island would be underwater. He gave some other explanations as well. But he was making really a larger point about what this institution had to face, and what this city has to face about this institution. We pay for it, we own it, we send our citizens there. As we've heard in report after report, much of the management there has been troubled and has yielded the exact opposite of what was supposed to go on there. So let me start by asking Martin Horn to give us the numbers. I mean, to talk in a practical way. You've written at least one article that sort of just breaks it down, that this is not pie in the sky, this is not advocacy, this is really just a description of, if you wanted to reconfigure how you handle pretrial detention and sentences of under a year, you could do it in a very different way, and it might yield some important improvements for the city.
Thanks, Errol. Nice to know you were paying attention and remembered all that. I vaguely remember that conversation, and I was somewhat gratified to hear the controller report about the damage from Hurricane Sandy, because they kept predicting the hurricane damage and it just never happened. So finally, it happened. Let me just start by saying a couple of things, and I will try and answer your question. And that is this. The first is, jail sucks. And jail will always suck. Prisons do too, but jails more so, just because of the very nature of jails. Our lack of investment, the notion that the individuals in jail are there for detention. Jails are factories of despair and despondency and idleness. Idleness is the prevailing atmosphere. Whenever I visited Rikers Island, it was the idleness that struck me the most. And young men are not intended to be in those kinds of settings. The second thing is that the buildings that New York City uses, as Glenn said, the 10 different jails on Rikers Island. Rikers Island is not one jail. It's 10 separate jails. The buildings themselves are terrible. Actually, the best designed buildings are probably the buildings that were built in 1937. The buildings that were built in the 60s and the 70s, to paraphrase Shakespeare, I guess, was it Shakespeare? First, let's hang the lawyer, let's hang the architects, because whoever designed those buildings should be executed. They're terrible. And they serve as arsenals, hardly arsenals of democracy, but arsenals of mayhem. And no matter what we do to try and keep contraband weapons out of Rikers Island, it's to no avail, because the prisoners will just continue to pull the weapons off the floors and the walls and the heating ducts and whatever. So the one other thing I want to mention is that, as Glenn mentioned, his experience in 1987, none of this is new. And for those of you who have been around New York City long enough, you'll recall in the 90s when violence and mayhem on Rikers Island coincided with a jail population of over 20,000, the tabloids were full of screaming headlines about problems on Rikers Island. And the solution that the city chose at the time was men in turtle suits, and to empower a new gang on Rikers Island, and that gang was called, it was the gang in blue, it was the officers under the leadership of then Commissioner Kerrick. And so the city forcibly took back control and imposed peace on the warring factions. And this tendency towards violence has always been there, and it was my experience that the best you could do was lean on it and bend the line, and I like to think I did it a little bit, but I wasn't able to institutionalize that change, and partly that's because of Rikers Island, and it's because the city of New York, we, all of us, have chosen to put our children and our neighbors on this place and to define them as other than ourselves. And the men and women who work there can't help but get the message. And they get the message as well that they don't count for much either. If you look at the respect that we give them, the training that we give them, it pales by comparison to that which we give to policemen and firemen. And so we ought not be surprised when they don't behave the way we would like them to. But back then there were 21,000 at one point, I think, prisoners as recently as 1995. And the last I checked, today we're down to about 11,000 prisoners. To get to Errol's specific question, of the 11,000, probably 800 or 900 of them are prisoners who are serving a sentence, because not everybody in the city's jails is pretrial. They are individuals who have been convicted of a misdemeanor, or in some cases a felony, and received a sentence of less than 1 year. And they are serving that time in New York City custody. And when the city first planted its penal flag on Rikers, it was to establish what was then called the penitentiary. I think they now call it the James A. Thomas Center, whatever. But it made some sense, if you were going to have a sentenced population, to do that. Then as the city's jail population and the city itself grew, and there was no place in the community to build jails. The city built more and more jails for pretrial detention on Rikers Island. Everyone will recall that there was a time when there was an urgent cry in the city to raise the women's house of detention in Greenwich Village. And everyone was delighted when that happened. And instead, we got the Rose M. Singer Center. Poor Rose M. Singer. She deserves better than that. And so we replaced the women's jail in the heart of Greenwich Village with a women's jail on Rikers Island. So we've got about 11,000 prisoners today, as I say, 800 or 900 of whom are sentenced prisoners. If, to get to my formulation, if through bail reform, through swifter processing of prisoners, if the city were adjudicating criminal cases, that is from the point of arrest to the point of final disposition, whether it be dismissal, conviction, whatever, today, as fast as they were 20 years ago, there would be several thousand fewer people confined on in the city's jails. So if we did that, and if the state legislature acted on the several proposals it has in front of it to change the age of criminal responsibility, and we moved the juveniles, right? 3 years ago, the Sentencing Commission that Judge Lippman established, of which I serve as executive director, made, I thought, a good proposal to do just that. And it hasn't happened. It hasn't happened because nobody wants to pay the bill. The minute you begin to define the 16 and 17-year-olds who are now on Rikers Island and elsewhere in the state as juveniles, the cost of their custody shifts from the state to the county. And or from the jail to the county, and probably doubles. And that's why the New York State Association of Counties, and indeed the city of New York, has opposed that change, because they won't vote for it until the governor and the state legislature agree to indemnify them for the cost. But assuming that you could get rid of several hundred of the 16 and 17-year-olds, assuming that you could speed up the processing time and reduce the population by a further 1,000 or 1,500, and assuming that we did a good job with diverting the mentally ill, which I think we could do a far better job of, I think it's within the realm of possibility that the city's jail population that it really is responsible for, and there's always going to be a jail population, let's not kid ourselves, there's never going to be a time when the city doesn't have to have a jail and a system of jails, could get down to the neighborhood of 6,000. If you had 6,000 prisoners, you could, within the existing zoning allowance, rebuild the Brooklyn House of Detention and house 1,600 people there. I tried to do that in 2005, 2006. You could, on the site of the Vernon C. Bain Center, the barge in the Bronx adjacent to the Bronx Terminal Market, you could, on that site, replace the barge, which currently holds about 800 people, and build at least 1,600 beds there. So you'd have a 1,600-bed facility in the heart of Brooklyn, physically near the courts, connected physically to the Brooklyn Criminal Court building, and a building in the South Bronx, just a few moments away from the Bronx Criminal Courts on 161st Street, 1,600. That's 3,200 beds. There are about 800 or 900 beds in Manhattan at the Tombs. Let's accept for a moment that that probably can't be changed. So right there, you've got 4,000 beds. In Queens, the old Queens House of Detention was built for about 400, but people I've spoken to say that if you raised that building down to its foundations, you could probably build a state-of-the-art building for 1,000 there. That's 5,000 beds in well-designed, modern buildings designed not to be cannibalized for weapons, designed humanistically, with good air circulation, with air conditioning, with access to light, with living units that respect human dignity, with classrooms, with space to do all the things we would wish to have our jails do. That's 5,000 beds. I'll accept that close to 1,000 of the sentenced prisoners may have to remain on Rikers Island. but you would have then four facilities, each no larger than 1,600 people, far more manageable, located in the boroughs, near the courts, and the sentenced prisoners would remain on Rikers Island. I think that's doable. Now, what's the impediment, Errol? The impediment is simply politics. The way it works in New York City is we have a land use process. It's called ULURP. I tried to go through it in Brooklyn. I claimed there was no change in use and that we could take the existing facility in Brooklyn within the zoning allowance, increase its size, and have a 1,600-bed facility. One of Mr. Stringer's predecessors, Bill Thompson, took me to court and forced us. We thought it was no change in use. It didn't have to go through the land use process. Controller Thompson argued differently. A judge in Brooklyn ruled against us. We had to go through ULURP. And the way it works in New York City is if the city council person whose district the facility is located in objects, then the city council will not approve it, and that's the final step of the city's land use review process. And as long as the city council person who represents the district where the Brooklyn House is, the city council person who represents Kew Gardens where the Queens House is, and the city council person who represents where the barge is, object, that will not happen. It is not about the mayor, it is not about the governor, and indeed it's not even about the money, because there are architects in the room who would probably tell you that within 20, 25 years, these projects could pay for themselves by being more staffing efficient, by reducing transportation costs, by reducing some of the centralized costs we have with respect to just running Rikers Island, running two bus lines, running the perimeter security, keeping that bridge going, all those crazy things that we do because we put all of our people on Rikers Island. So, Errol, that's the answer. It could be done. It's simply a matter of political will. Is the mayor willing to lean on three council members? Is the speaker of the council prepared to lean on three council members? Are three council members prepared to do what they want? At the end of the day, the city gets the jails that it wants.
Okay. That is an interesting proposal. An interesting proposal that I'll keep raising, year after year, month after month. It makes too much sense not to at least consider it. Now, Neil Barsky, you wrote a piece not that long ago calling for Rikers to be closed, making a slightly different argument, right?
Not that different. I mean, I didn't get into the minutiae of the city council, but I did say, I would echo what Marty said. Glenn Martin made the moral case for closing Rikers. And, as a citizen of New York, I say that's pretty irrefutable. There's not a human being who would recreate Rikers if we started from scratch. It's a broken system in every way. But it's really not a moral argument. Ultimately, morality is not going to close Rikers. Rikers has been this way for years. And Controller Springer made an economic argument. There's more efficient ways to run Rikers. There's more efficient, and Marty too, there are more efficient ways to do this. It's really not about economics either, because at some point it may become more expensive, depending on how it falls. I think ultimately closing Rikers is about two things. It is about politics, and it's about the politics of fear. From a political perspective, it's true that ultimately the ULURP process and the bills could be blocked by the city council people whose districts the jails would be. But it is about the courage of our real politicians, our mayor, our controller, our governor. And Glenn implied that he was disappointed in the mayor's policy or perspective on criminal justice. I had been less discouraged until about 2 weeks ago, frankly. And when I appeared on your show, you said, are we one horrible event away from backsliding? I mean, we're all into criminal justice reform now. And I said, no, I think this, as a society, we've grown up. We don't live in fear like we used to. And we're in a real great national moment. We can, there's bipartisanship. And one tragic incident in New York, the killing of a police officer, where the alleged assailant was out on parole, was not accused of a violent crime. It took that, I don't want to minimize it or trivialize it, but that's all it took for the mayor, the progressive mayor, to go to war against the judge who apparently complied with every guideline and politicized this instantaneously. And it is a horrible signal, in my opinion, for what lies ahead, because this is not going to be easy politically. I wish it was about three council people. It's about the New York Post and the Daily News and the New York Times editorial boards, et cetera. So that is a very unfortunate omen. And there's something else that recently happened, and that happened in Paris a few days ago. And we have 50 governors, I believe half of whom are now barring Syrian refugees from their for their borders. This is about fear, but it's also about something else. It's also about the demagoguery that exists around this issue. So, you know, I'm very hopeful. I believe it can be done. I think Commissioner Horn sort of outlined the mechanics of it, and I think the controller outlined some of the economics of it. But the real question ultimately to me is, as a society, are we willing to deal with our fears, which are real, and deal with the politics of criminal justice, where demagoguery has reared its head in every time something unfortunate has happened? And I'd like to be optimistic. I'm less optimistic now than when I did the piece in the summer. I think it takes political courage, and in this case, in New York City, it's going to have to start with the mayor. And I haven't, you know, the latest indication suggests that that may be a challenge.
Okay. Now, Anne Marie.
Pardon me.
Yeah, please jump in.
I would love to comment on this piece because it's really. Can you hear me?
Yep.
A matter of the in regards to bringing.
Try mine. Okay.
Hello? Okay. Yeah. All right. In regard to like addressing shutting down Rikers and bringing the numbers down, there's really a matter of politics. It's the politics of how we address crime. Like right now, our politicians and as well as society, our first result to addressing crime is incarcerating someone. And that's what has to change. Like immediately incarcerating people is not it's not what's gonna help. We need to start at the social levels in our communities. Like half of the people that are being, like Rikers is just straight grief. Like everyone that experienced Rikers from like from the correctional officers to the inmates in there, we just experienced grief, and especially the people from those communities, especially the urban communities. And we need to provide those urban communities with resources, with more education systems that are not just built on standard testing, but creating critical thinking, building critical thinking for our youth. And these are things that help our people in the community like stop going into like crime activity and different behavioral activities. It's a matter of our culture and our society needs to start looking at crime differently. We don't need to wait until crime happens. We need to address it way before crime starts. Crime starts at the heat of not being able to get your ends meet, not being able to do the things, having a home over your head, being able to get food in your system. And those are things that create a lot of the crimes that we encounter, and people that going through are funneled through these criminal justice system, which are mostly brown and black people. So we need to really look at how we're addressing crime in to begin with, not how we go with.
And this is a long-standing conversation, and those of you who work directly with youth, I know that this is something that young people are concerned about, right? I mean, they read the newspapers like the rest of us. They, in some ways, see that a path is being carved out for them, right? From the failing school to the inadequate job or the non-existent job to the aggressive policing to the jail that's waiting at the end of it. That of course, is no excuse for despair. So what do you say, Khary? What do you say to young people that we collectively, at least, have the power to sort of make a different path?
So first of all, I want to thank everybody for coming to this conversation. You know, to me, this is really personal, and I've talked about this before. I had a sister, buried on my 17th birthday. And I didn't learn restorative justice or criminal justice from going to university. I studied psychology, but I learned restorative justice from my father, who said he couldn't take another mother's child away from them. And then I had a brother who was in and out the system, so I grew up with a duality of the victim and a quote-unquote offender in my household. And at a very early age, I learned that my brother being incarcerated didn't only impact my brother and his life, but it impacted our whole family. And so for me, when I work with young people, I see myself in them. I went into the probation department after I had been working on creating detention alternatives with youth because I knew that if somebody like myself worked in that department, that people like my brother wouldn't be caught up in a system for 30 years. And so when I had gone to the academy, which was an interesting experience, I remember seeing images of individuals being put on the screen and our facilitator saying to us, that's the person that ultimately ends up in the system. And what I ended up seeing was somebody like myself, because I experienced all the trauma that those individuals on the screen had experienced. And for me, it's about creating positive alternatives. I work inside the Horizon Detention Center offering programming for young people. And I initially started a program 4 years ago because I came from Santa Cruz County, which was number one in the nation at the time for restorative justice. And I thought I was gonna come to New York to reform the system here. A very ambitious goal, which wasn't necessarily what I was able to accomplish. But there was a cultural shift that happened within the detention center with young people and the juvenile counselors that were working with the youth. We were able to build relationships with them. When I first walked into that facility, I remember being looked at like I actually was nobody. I was just another person who wanted to come and bring programming, and what do you care about these young people? You don't have to live with them 24 hours like we do. And I began to kind of speak to those that were working in the facility and learn that a lot of them had also experienced some of the same traumas. And I actually included them into our programming. So asking them, you know, what do you feel would work? And also trying to create a dialogue between the young people. But I remember seeing some of the juvenile officers putting their hands on the young people and just shoving them and telling them to shut up. And that used to really bother me. I've been in this field for 20 years now, and I had never seen that type of interaction. And I think it's also because I was very naive. I thought that maybe Santa Cruz was also in other places, but it wasn't. And so what I now do for young people is that we try to create this pipeline, but also empower them and give them voice. We use art, music, film, and culture as a tool for transformation, and also create a space for healing. A lot of the young people, you know, Glenn talked about Khalif Browder at Rikers. You know, yes, I agree with Glenn. We need to shut down Rikers, number one, but we also need to reform the whole system. We need to hold the system accountable. There was no reason why Khalif Browder was sent to Rikers because of allegations of him stealing a backpack. How horrendous is that? In another system that it was accountable, a risk assessment would have been implemented at intake, not when a young person sees a judge. So we really need to look deeper into the system and not allow policy institutions, to compromise real reform in this space because they're receiving money from the city or the state. But I will say for me, it's looking at how we create, how we also utilize and allow young people to utilize their voice on also feeling empowered to sit at this table. So I applaud the young brother at the very end, being able to sit up here and to share his experience and also to, you know, kind of say, wait a second, we also need to look a little deeper as to what programming is happening in our communities, because we know with the cost analysis that was mentioned earlier, $112,000 per inmate, when it costs $10,000 from kindergarten to 12th grade to educate a young person. And so when we look at long-term sustainability or long-term investment, we need to think about how we can actually remove some of that money that's going into incarceration and funnel it back to our communities.
Errol, can I just want to comment for a moment on the cost per inmate, and it's a valid point, and I don't mean to undermine it, but it's important that we understand the relationship between Rikers Island and concentrating all of the incarcerated people in the city in this one place and the cost. Because we operate this island, we incur the cost of patrolling the island itself. Visitors who come to the island have to get bused, so there's one bus system that buses the visitors around. The staff parks outside the perimeter, so there's a second bus system that buses the staff around. The prisoners have to get brought to 20-some-odd different courthouses around the city every day. And those are fixed costs. And those are costs that, so when the comptroller compares New York to Philadelphia, the cost, for example, of transferring prisoners back and forth to courthouses every day is not part of the Philadelphia Department of Corrections cost. They have a sheriff's department that comes and brings prisoners back and forth. And because you have these fixed costs, these centralized operational costs, as the prison, as the jail population decreases, by definition, the cost per day per prisoner is going to go up, right? Because these are fixed costs that stay whether you have 20,000 prisoners or 10,000 prisoners. If you got rid of the island and only had one facility there and didn't have to manage 10 facilities, you don't have those costs at the Tombs. You don't have them now in Brooklyn. You don't have them at the Barge. So I think it's an important consideration, but it's equally important as we proceed with this conversation that we understand the dynamic. And as and the further we decrease the population but hold on to Rikers Island, the more the cost per day per prisoner will go up.
And Anne-Marie, there's the work that you've been doing for and at Cases has been about alternative sentencing to sort of steer people away to the extent that they're in the court system already, but you can steer them away from the least effective, highest cost outcome, which is at this point Rikers, right?
Right. So at Cases, can people hear me?
Yeah.
So at Cases, we run alternatives to incarceration programs for people with mental illnesses. And so not the mentally ill Marty, but people with mental illnesses. I think the distinction is really important. It's a very, very important distinction.
I stand corrected.
Thank you. And so our ability to run these programs, though, and the question about closing down Rikers Island is about what's in the community. Mm-hmm. And so to Khalif's, but to Charles's point about what is in the community. So for people with mental illnesses, our ability, and we know that they represent maybe about 40% of the population on any given day in our jail, has to be that the community, all of us, are willing to invest in having the infrastructure, which means supportive housing, which means sort of mental health treatment programs, which means opportunities for connection to family and opportunities for people to go to work. All of those things are going to be really, really sort of important for us. I wanted to also respond to one of the things that the controller said, and so he described that there are different populations. He said there are youth, he said they are the violent and the non-violent. In the criminal justice world, there's always the focus on people, the non-violent offender. Mm-hmm. Well, I actually haven't met that person. People have a whole range of prior convictions. The issue is about the dangerous person. That's what we're concerned about. So Khalif Brower, allegedly robbing the backpack, robbery is a violent crime in terms of New York State penal law. So we're all saying he should not have been in. And so I think that's an important distinction for us as members of the community to appreciate that there are people who are allegedly convicted of, who are arrested for violent crimes who can be safely managed in the community. Mm-hmm. There are people who are convicted of violent crimes who can be safely managed in the community. And so our ability to close down Rikers Island, to reduce the population, has to be our tolerance also around the fear related to that. And so in my experience, I'm working with someone that has schizophrenia. So we know that in the US population, we're afraid of people with mental illness. That is true. That hasn't gone away. When researchers researched in the 1960s, the general population's response to people with mental illness, the fear around people and the stigma around people with mental illness has been constant. It's very high. Really sort of high stigma. But the nuance about someone who has who's been convicted, pled guilty, been found guilty of engaging in violent behavior, which is terrible. You know, nobody should be victimized. We should be really concerned about victims. That is really, really critical. We want no new crimes and no new victims. But we have to have in our society, if we're going to achieve what is being asked of us here today, the capacity to allow that person to return to the community safely with whatever it takes to allow that person to return safely. The issue about jails is everyone comes home. Even the people that go to state prison come home. And so the investment in people who may be the highest risk, the ones that we don't want to invest in because it's not politically savvy to say, let's work with people who have been convicted of violent crimes, I would argue, is critical around this debate. It's really critical.
Mm-hmm. That is certainly a politically heavy lift, for sure, what you just described, but it is where the conversation is. And let's keep in mind, I mean, there have been some successes in this policy debate, right? I mean, when you know, in the late 1990s, when the first discussions about reinvestment and reentry were being talked about, it really, I mean, I thought it was going to stay at the level of different conferences that I was kind of crashing and eavesdropping on. And lo and behold, you put in reentry into your Google search engine. You can go to the U.S. Department of Justice, and there's money for it, and there's best practices, and there's seminars, and there's all kinds of stuff going on. And yet, what you just described is still not necessarily part of the mainstream conversation. It's still kind of a specialized discussion, isn't it? The even just the mere fact that, as you just described, something like 90%+ of everybody who is incarcerated for any reason is going to end up back home sooner or later.
Right, and I think that one of the things that we know is that, you know, we in New York City, through our city sort of government, the Mayor's Office of Criminal Justice, the Mayor's Task Force on Behavioral Health and Criminal Justice, are really trying to address this. The Mayor announced New York Safe, which is about that tiny cluster of folks that are the ones that we really, really worry about, that, you know, we're very, very concerned about, the sort of investment in resources to make sure they don't fall through the cracks because of poor coordination, the lack of specialized interventions. We have mental health courts, we have diversion programs specific to people with serious mental illnesses, as well as sort of within cases, our youth program and other agencies are sort of doing this, but no one is going to publicize it. But it is happening. You know, I know our experience is that we see that for people with serious mental illnesses who were convicted of a violent crime, which could be an assault or a robbery, or going into someone's home and eating chicken because you were hungry, going into someone's home, it's a residence, that's always a violent crime in New York State because of the potential. So even if someone's not in the home or the person's upstairs and you were just eating chicken and you didn't do anything for them, we as members of the public have to realize that that's a violent crime in New York. And it should be, because there's a potential for someone to victimize somebody. But that person has been diverted safely, and we see that in all of these programs where they're not in the daily news or being publicized, that the rates at which people are re-victimized, rates at which people actually recidivate and then do another violent crime is minuscule. You know, it's much more significantly better than the national average, where in some studies we see, you know, 70% of prisoners return to prison within 3 years. That's a standard. And so again, it's sort of our tolerance about this. You know, we know that the Manhattan District Attorney's Office is doing an initiative on young people that are arrested of robberies and trying new interventions around electronic monitoring. So I think we are at this moment where we can really sort of address who's on Rikers Island, who needs to be there, how we get people off who don't need to be there, but even for sort of high-risk folks, like how can we respond effectively so that we're all safe?
And I just wanted to clarify one thing. With Khalif Browder's case, although he was charged with a violent crime, the witness had actually went back to Mexico, and ultimately they still kept him. And he was in isolated for over 200 days. And so I just want to be very clear, if we had tools that were set up to hold our system accountable, there would be a lot of people that don't deserve to be in Rikers at this moment.
Mm-hmm. You know, that's a very important point, because it's not just Khalif Browder, it was also Jerome Murdaugh. Mm-hmm. Right? And so you part of the problem is that individuals who get arrested, who are our brothers and sisters, our children and our neighbors, are treated as widgets on the assembly line of justice. And no one individual, no one functionary, no one owns the responsibility. Who owned the responsibility for why Khalif Browder's case dragged mm-hmm. on as long as it did? Who owned the responsibility for why Jerome Murdaugh, a veteran with PTSD who was found on the roof of a New York City Housing Authority building, was locked up? The judge owns a piece of it, the defense attorney owns a piece of it, the prosecutor owns a piece of it, and we don't talk enough about their ownership. And part of the problem is the fragmentation of our criminal justice system. Somebody needs to be looking at each case and saying, I am responsible for seeing that justice gets done and that it gets done swiftly and smartly, and nobody has that responsibility in our system.
Mm-hmm. Although it's worth pointing out, at least nominally, almost every officer of the court you just named has that responsibility. I mean, I tried to chase it down with Khalif Browder and tried to talk to the district attorney, who wouldn't talk publicly.
But if everybody has it, nobody has it.
Right, 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 understood. Charles, I know you started to touch on this. There's a, whether or not one has been officially diagnosed with a mental health disability, there are a lot of mental health issues that need to get dealt with, right? I mean, that's part of this whole equation?
Yes, definitely. All right, so in regards to like mental health, and when it comes to Rikers Island and dealing with people who have mental illnesses, we need to look at first, before they're even diagnosed, there's some people who are not even diagnosed, right? And they're not getting the treatment that they need. And there's people who are diagnosed. We actually have one of our clients who has been diagnosed with a mental illness, and he's actually not getting the services he needs to be getting at Rikers currently, like right now. But we need to look at the bigger picture of once you get into Rikers, a young person, especially 16, 17-year-old, but anyone, that embedded culture of violence in Rikers. I was in Rikers for 6 months when I was 17 years old, and I went through a three-week span of fighting literally every single day and having to talk to my mom, to my brother with like bruises on my face and not wanting to explain it because I didn't want to put that burden on them, telling them I'm okay, don't even worry about it. But that aspect of dealing with all the violence, and then also for like 16 and 17 year olds, when you're there, you're not considered a person. You're more acknowledged as from your bed number or from your cell number. So this combination of not having a awareness of self, plus all the violence that you're enduring and these traumatizing events that you're seeing, it creates mental instability. And everyone in Rikers should have an opportunity to talk to a mental health specialist. And it should be in a matter of not just, oh, you need to talk to this mental health specialist, but you need to, if you haven't gotten a visit in a while, just because of the stigma that's in urban communities that's with talking to a mental health specialist. They say, oh, you're talking to a shrink. You shouldn't be talking to a shrink. But we need to have those opportunities for every single person in Rikers to talk to a mental health specialist and to talk about these events that are taking place. And just to give you an example of it was that before I went into Rikers, I was able to go into a classroom. And this is a totally new classroom, totally new people. I don't know anyone there. I'm willing to engage. I was willing to smile. I was willing to talk and introduce myself. Once I was in Rikers, I was going into different housing areas. That was no longer the case. I had to put on this face every day and make sure that I wasn't approachable because I knew that every situation was able to lead to a confrontation of violence. And that was something that once you encounter those things, you have to be able to talk to someone about it and be able to see the difference of one compared to how you would deal with that situation when you're out in society.
I want to offer a few comments of different things that, you know, kind of panelists have said, and I really appreciate the last point that you made because I think it goes to this issue of kind of humanity and how we as a society want to treat people. I really appreciated Glenn's opening comments around the issue of kind of the morality of this issue. I disagree with others who have said that they think that the moral argument is clear. I actually don't agree with that. I don't agree with the comptroller either that the moral argument has been established. I mean, we know that there has been supervision of the system before. We know that there's been a federal monitor before. We now have a U.S. attorney comparing Rikers to Lord of the Flies. We have a U.S. attorney saying that the system is broken. We have a U.S. attorney saying that there is a culture of violence pervasive throughout the system. I've heard members of the current administration and previous administration detail ways that you could take the population from 10,000 to 5,000. I've been hearing it for a decade. So the question is, if this has already been articulated by policy makers, if we have currently the most progressive administration we've ever seen in New York City, if we have an administration that says that it wants to transform the issue, where is the big vision thinking? Why is it not occurring? Where is the political capital and skin in the game? And I think that the answer is that the people on Rikers Island are poor and overwhelmingly black and brown. And as a society and as a city, it is not a priority. A lot of people of good faith say it is, but it's not a priority. And what I mean by that is it's very easy for progressive New Yorkers to say, oh, well, this is horrible. I read in the New York Times with my coffee, you know, over the summer what was occurring on Rikers It's very easy for progressive people to articulate to their friends and their colleagues their views on the issue. The question is, where is it on your priority list? Where are 10,000 incarcerated people on the island on the priority list of this administration, of progressive people in this city? There are roughly 400 children on the island. For a second, imagine that one of those 400 children was your child. Imagine one night on Rikers Island by children who are being assaulted, forced to fight, raped. This is by the U.S. Attorney's report. Where would your voice be? Where would it be on your priority list? At Brotherhood Sister Soul, we have young people who have been put on Rikers Island for robbing another person in their high school of their earphones, for possession of marijuana, for being in a park with no ID and then arguing with the police officer, for open containers and then arguing with the police officer. Bail is supposed to be for a threat to society, okay? Bail is supposed to be established not for those who are too poor to pay. So the question is, how many people in this room themselves or know somebody who has used an illegal drug, who've had an open container, who have argued with a police officer during a protest, who has maybe had a fight during their high school years, has done something illegal? Now imagine spending time in Rikers Island. And so I don't believe the moral argument has sufficiently been made for this to be a priority, because the children being incarcerated on Rikers, the adults being incarcerated, are demonized. And so when you said earlier, Errol, what do we say to our young people? We talk about violence prevention all the time. We talk about the fact that, unfortunately, our community, places like Harlem and Washington Heights, are overrun by violence. So we talk to young people about conflict resolution, how not to be violent, rejecting twisted norms of masculinity and manhood. We do all that work. But as a country, we are an unbelievably violent country, right? And that's not an issue of black and brown people. That's an issue actually of men, of manhood, right? This is a country that has a crisis with masculinity. Over 10,000 people were killed in the United States last year by gunfire. Less than 100 in Japan. Less than 100 in England. Less than 100 in Germany. And while, yes, black and brown men are disproportionately represented, the number one killer of other people in this country are white men, right? So if we look at the fact that as a country, we are inundated with violence, we incarcerate people at a higher level than anyone, what are we doing around those systems? And so I know today we're talking about Rikers, but I think it's essential that we look at the national issue, because number one, there's this American phenomenon of incarcerating people in a way that no one else in the world does. This brutal system, right? Eddie Ellis used to say he's been in many correctional facilities. He's never been in one that corrected anybody, right? And so what is the approach to incarceration on a national level? The reason we come back to Rikers, though, and why today's conversation to me is so important, is because there's a supposed opportunity in the city right now. That if we, again, are the most progressive city in America, if we have the most progressive administration, then this is a time for the articulation of a complete reformation of how we deal with those who get caught up in the criminal justice system. And if we don't push that big vision now, if we don't push it today, I'm not sure when it will be pushed. And so the final point I want to make about this is that what's so damaging around this conversation is that as we incarcerate people at a level that we have never seen before, even with the decrease in the population in Rikers, what we're looking at on a national level, if we know that the way people are being incarcerated violates at minimum two aspects of the Constitution, the Eighth Amendment in terms of cruel and unjust penalties, and the 14th in terms of due process, if we know that that's the fact, if we know that the economic analysis is that this system is not working, if we certainly know that it's not doing anything to deal with the issue of recidivism, then we keep coming back to one central question, in my opinion. Why as a society, New York or the United States, do we allow a system that has been deemed bankrupt in all of those ways to continue? And I submit that it keeps coming back to who is incarcerated in an institution like Rikers. And we have to keep pushing that.
You know, you raised something that I have encountered over the years, and it's one of those realizations that can sort of defeat you, kind of set you back a little bit. You know, the notion that maybe this isn't some accident that we're wasting all of this money on futility. Maybe somebody actually wants to buy this, and then you think about what the this is, and it's not a pretty picture. You talk in some ways about a culture of violence that goes beyond Rikers Island and is a citywide, even national issue of violence. I want to push that though a little bit and maybe expand it to this notion of who is deserving of something resembling rehabilitation, mercy, alternatives to incarceration, and who deserves harsh punishment. Because while it may not be spelled out in the policy, there is an underlying discussion. It usually comes out in the form of tabloid headlines, and having worked for years and years at a tabloid, I can tell you that that doesn't come from nowhere, right? This is how people think about it. It maybe jumps a little bit too quickly from the subconscious to the front page without enough, you know, sort of mediation in between. But those are real feelings. Those are real sentiments that New Yorkers have. And it partly answers, I think, some of this question of how you can elect a progressive administration that says a lot of things about, hey, let's make some change. But, you know, you've also got millions of people who will go out and buy that newspaper and who will rail against the judge who makes a call that they think was wrong. I don't even know that we have really a coherent conversation in the city about what the purpose of jail or prison is. Is it to simply incapacitate people because they're permanently dangerous and we'll just sort of take them off the street for a little while? Is it for actual rehabilitation? Is it for restorative justice? Is it, you know, what's it about? How do we get that conversation going?
Errol, I have to try and address your question because it's exactly the right question. The first part of your question, I think the answer to that is everybody is deserving of mercy and justice and rehabilitation and redemption and an opportunity. It's about human dignity, and it's about how we define who we select for this treatment that, or whatever it is we do. And I'm with Eddie Ellis. I've been in a lot of prisons and correctional institutions, and I don't think they correct anybody either. And so I think the best answer is we have to be awfully parsimonious and about who we lock up. Our goal should be to lock up the least number of people for the least amount of time. And, you know, I'm not afraid to say that incapacitation is not such a terrible thing. There are some people who really scare me. I don't know. Take your pick. The Unabomber. I don't know. The Washington Sniper. I don't know. There are some people out there that are really scary and who, if they're sort of out and about, none of the rest of us can lead our lives. And we all really do want to be protected from them. And then we can put aside the conditions under which they should be kept. Nobody should be kept in inhumane conditions. But I think the reality is that jails exist for one purpose and one purpose only, and that is to hold individuals who otherwise would not appear for trial. They're not to punish. They're not to rehabilitate, really, although once we have the person, we should try and help them because that serves our own interests as a society and a community. But and it's not for risk, and it's not for punishment. Jails exist to hold people who otherwise would not appear for trial, and that's the bottom line for that. And prisons exist, and we need them to incapacitate people who really could hurt a lot of other people, and we ought not pretend that prisons are going to correct or rehabilitate anybody. Because they don't. They're, by definition, destructive of the human spirit.
I don't want to derail us from this conversation, but I do want to say it's really interesting to me because prisons are made for who, right? I've also been in prisons across the country, and it's predominantly Black and Latino men. And that's the reality, and we need to talk about the structures of racism and white supremacy and the fact that we, at this moment, are housing Black and Latino people across the board in prisons. And so when we ask the question, you know, let's define what jails are really made for, but really, who are they made for? Right? We look at those that are in poverty. Yesterday I went to a conversation in Delaware, and there was this judge talking about, we cannot use the word white supremacy because we don't want to turn people off. And you know, and I was listening to him speak, and this is a judge who said on his panel that there are white kids that make really poor decisions, but there are poor kids that make even stupider ones. Black and Latino kids. And so I want to hear, you know, from this panel is like, who are these prisons made up for? Because if we actually are talking about Rikers and we're talking about prison reform, we need to really deal with the systemic issue that is funneling our people into those systems.
Right on.
Yes.
No. So I just want to sort of share quickly. So that's why the notion of different populations. So women who are in Rikers Island are predominantly Black and Latino. People with serious mental illnesses who are in Rikers are predominantly Black and Latino. Like, this is an important thing. Like, these distinctions, and youth who are in Rikers are predominantly Black and Latino. So the notion of the population and the special populations on Rikers is Black and Latino people. And so I thank you for raising that. It's just true, though. And that's why the community piece is really important. And so for me, I think my experience is there's something about how the mental health system doesn't work for African-American males and Latino males. That is true. That is true. Do you know what I mean? And I think we need to, so I really appreciate everyone raising it, because I think that that's really important. So Rikers has men and women who are Black and Latino, and the mental health, the people with mental illness are also that. You know, the people with mental illness are not different than the people who don't have mental illness on Rikers Island. So I think that the sort of racial thing is really, I think, important, because it's not just about cultural competency. I have issues about the notion of cultural competency. I really do believe in anti-discriminatory practice. I'm from England. In England, we have less people in jail, more Black men in jail. Do you know? And so that replicates itself. Mm-hmm. Societies replicate that regardless of it being New York City. Do you know, when in London, the local jail that I knew, Wormwood Scrubs, there were Black men in that jail, you know, and they were overrepresented according to the population. So this is not a phenomenon specific to New York City or the US, mass incarceration maybe, but the notion of who's in the jail and who's it for is something that I think that we have to appreciate in Western society, white Western society, that it is for Black people. Like, that's just, like, that would be stupid not to do that. And I was a probation officer in England. You know, who was I writing reports on, and who was I going to visit? They were Black men.
Mm-hmm. Yes, no, I would love to say, no, thank you for bringing the candid part of this. It's really a matter of acknowledging that Black and brown people are the ones filling up these jails. And is this accidental? We need to really ask that question. This is not accidental. Like, this system has been put laws, like with the Rockefeller laws. Who is it really affecting? It was affecting Black and brown people. These police are put in urban communities. They're not put in white, high economic level communities. No, like those people would go to their council members, would go to their legislators and get police out of there if they're harassing their children. But in our Black community, we don't really understand exactly how the policies work, and we don't have the time to get involved with like our politics. And a lot of these things have to do with the political issue and how much like things are being directed at our Black and brown communities. And we need to address that fact and know that these detriments of putting us immediately into incarceration, it's not accidental. Like, it's things that have been happening for decades on now. It started with the form of slavery, and now it's gone into like going from like incarceration and not letting us be able to do things, get jobs once we get out of it, be able to get housing out of it. And these things also perpetuate crime further down. So we need to look at what's going on in our community and our society with who and what prisons are made for.
Neil Barsky, you know, we all got to look at a different part of the state and a different part of this whole question with the escape and recapture and killing of David Sweat and Richard Matt. And it reminded me of the excellent work that
the Marshall Project has been doing on reporting on, I mean, that blockbuster set of articles about the situation up at Attica and what goes on in some of the far reaches of the state that most of us rarely visit and most have never heard of.
Yeah.
You've been trying to sort of build a case that we understand this better and do something. I wanted to get your assessment of how that would relate to this conversation.
Well, sure. The Marshall Project, as people may know, is a nonprofit journalism organization dedicated to covering the criminal justice system. The basis for the Marshall Project is very simple. It's twofold. One is, and I'm just echoing what's been said, the criminal justice system in America is ineffective, it's expensive, it's racist, and it's broken. But speaking to what the solution is and how do we get from here to here, we had this idea, and it may be naive and it may be dead wrong, because I think the powers against reform are very strong. But the idea is that journalism, truth, storytelling, done fairly, aggressively, and truthfully, can elevate this issue to one of national urgency, and that what we need in this country is, yes, we need to radically reform the system, but first we need a national conversation. Yeah. We need to make this as important in a political campaign as taxes and immigration and the Ukraine, and this should be on the front burner. And that was the precise idea behind the Marshall Project, using journalism, and we are nonpartisan. If you read our articles, the articles by Tom Robbins that were done in the Times but were written by the Marshall, you know, edited and assigned by the Marshall Project, there's no paragraph that says this underscores the racism of the system, although Tom may feel that way and many of us may feel that way. But we like being in the front page of the New York Times. And we like reaching audiences that may not automatically agree with this panel. And I believe that, you know, you mentioned Clinton, and the New York Times followed up that story, if you recall. Shortly after the two gentlemen escaped, the guards got together and said, who's collaborating? And they beat the crap out of a lot of the people there. And later we learned that it was actually the corrections officers who were collaborating. And what's been amazing in New York, the New York Times has done a series on Greenhill, on Clinton, we've done Attica, and you know, I don't know how many medium and maximum security prisons there are in New York, probably 25 or 30. It is a little, journalistically, it's a little like shooting fish in a barrel. It's like anywhere you go, it seems there's a story to be told, an outrage. And we've been talking internally at the Marshall, like, what is going on in Iowa? What's going on in Alabama? When you, in New York at least, we have something called the Correctional Association, which is a nonprofit that has access to prisons and can, you know, advocate on behalf of them. It's one of only two nonprofits in the country that can do that. So, you know, we are, you know, storytellers, hopefully truth tellers, and the idea is to stimulate a national conversation and create a sense of urgency. But if I could just say one more thing about the challenges. Last month, our editor, Bill Keller, had an opportunity to interview the president. And it was in a panel about reform with some law enforcement officials. And the president spoke, I think, for the first time publicly about Black Lives Matter and the Black Lives Matter movement. And it was a part of a very, very long answer, about 10-minute answer, and he navigated it so carefully. And he said how dangerous it is to be a law enforcement officer, and he understands, and how 90-something percent or the vast majority of law enforcement officers are doing their job and doing it well. And then he paused, and this is to an audience of people from criminal justice. He says, but trust me, we have an issue here. This is about policing in the African-American community. He said, the African-American community is not making this up. And I thought that was so powerful, particularly as we saw, because the president has these challenges that most officials who are not African-American don't have, which is that they have to speak this broad, general, global. And it was very, very powerful. And the next day, if you turn on Fox, it's like the president sides with cop killers. I mean, he couldn't have done it any more carefully. And yet the distortion of his words was quite strong. And so that's why I keep going back to the politics and maybe what I'm, you know, focused on. It's very hard, and I don't have the answer, but I believe, and naively, if we look at the Vietnam War or the Civil Rights Movement, public opinion was framed by people without predispositions going and reporting truthfully. The marchers are going over the bridge. I should pause for that. And they're being attacked by dogs or things in Vietnam. So we believe that journalism can be quite powerful, although I could be persuaded differently because the challenges are really very strong, societal.
Do you have a sense of whether or not, I mean, I've been watching all of these presidential debates, and I don't know whether to be dismayed that these issues haven't come up or relieved
yes.
that they haven't come up, because the conversations have been so strange.
That's a great point. I've been a little disappointed that the Republicans, because there are all the, you know, Rand Paul has been sort of at the forefront of reform in some ways. I at first was disappointed that it hasn't yet come about, but given the level of the debate, a level of discourse, I'm not trying to be sarcastic. I mean, it really has almost, like, look at immigration. Immigration's a very real issue in this country, and there has not been, and because of the candidates and the positions they've taken, the extreme positions, we haven't had an intelligent conversation about it. So in some ways, it may be better not to at this point, but I hope, but I do hope that come when it's the Democrat versus the Republican, whoever they may be, I'd be very disappointed given all the work that's people in this panel, the Marshall Project, and people of really goodwill on both sides. I'd be very disappointed if criminal justice reform was not one of the five or six issues that they're forced to deal with. That's the underpinning of what we're doing. It's underpinning of what a lot of us here are doing. So I'm hopeful, and I think it will, actually. I do feel we still have a lot of opportunity.
Well, in fact, let's talk about that. I'd like to hear from everybody on the panel. We've got a presidential election that is upon us. New Yorkers are going to go to the polls in April. We've got a re-election campaign for the city administration that includes all of the council members plus the mayor and the citywide offices, and that's going to pretty much get underway in earnest the minute after the presidential election is over. So all of this is coming up. And what are some of the reform items that you think would sort of help leverage change in a positive direction? What you know, and I say this not even as a hypothetical, because any of you who have worked on campaigns may realize this, that at a surprisingly late stage of the game, a candidate will look to his or her advisors and say, well, you know, where's the criminal justice plan? Oh, I don't know. Let's get you know, Freddie to do it. And Freddie will be a graduate student who's been hanging around the office, and they'll send him out with some pizza, and they'll come back with something, and it might be smart, and it might not be smart, and it might be well thought through or not, but it'll get sort of spiffed up and given out to the press, and you know, the eventual winner will eventually have made policy on the fly that the rest of the city, the state, or the nation, and people are free to disagree with me, but I've been part of that process. I mean, this is really how it goes to a great extent. So this is not hypothetical. What are some good policy proposals that somebody, whether it's the mayor, the governor, or the next president, or the next Congress, should be adopting?
I would like to start off, and I would say one in regards to how we just have the Fair Chance Act passed in New York City this past October 27th, it was implemented. I would say having a form of that Fair Chance Act in which everyone who is convicted of a felony, like in regards not just unemployment, but in putting that process in housing, putting it when looking for benefits, that action of having to disclose your conviction doesn't come till like that later part once when it comes to housing until you're offered a housing appointment, you know, because it's like people who have been giving, who have gotten convictions, it's extremely hard to get different housings due based on their conviction. Getting different employments, that just changed now, so we'll see how that reform goes and how it is actually implemented. But having that form of ban a box in just about every aspect, from housing to public to getting benefits and to getting insurance and stuff like that, and even fair credit checks. So. And higher education. So we need to have that in a broad sense in which that question is not asked until like the later part of your offered whatever you're seeking.
No particular order?
I'm part of an initiative called Justice League NYC, and we marched from New York City to DC with what we called the criminal justice package. And we marched to end racial profiling, demilitarize the police, and also a juvenile justice bill called the Juvenile Justice Delinquency Prevention Act. But what we found when we were meeting with several folks from Congress was that a lot of them weren't necessarily coordinated. There are about 240 bills in Congress at this moment that are criminal justice bills. And so our team is currently compiling them all together. We're working with Hank Johnson's office. But what they didn't even know is that the Republican Party has what's called Right on Crime. And they've been doing that for quite some time. And so we need to push our elected officials to really not get the intern from the university to report on what criminal justice packages, but to actually bring those in this space who are actually experts to put something and develop something together. But I will also say on a statewide level, I know for us and a lot of groups here, it's also about raising the age of criminal responsibility and having a comprehensive raise the age bill.
Raise the age bills, yeah.
So can we envision Bill de Blasio running for re-election and his platform being let's enact raise the age? Can we envision that happening?
Not right. Today.
Can we envision Bill de Blasio running for office and saying we're going to close down these big, out-of-date, poorly designed, dehumanizing factories of despair on Rikers Island, and we're going to build smaller jails for fewer people in Kew Gardens in Brooklyn Heights?
I don't know. I mean, you know,
you'd like to cover that campaign, right?
Well, it would be interesting, but no, I mean, I spent a lot of time in Brooklyn Heights. My kid goes to school down there, and, you know, I mean, the fact that there's an underground tunnel from the House of Detention to the criminal court, I mean, it's but safe. It's not.
Does everybody remember that, was it a year, 18 months ago, the state proposed to move its parole offices that are currently located on like Skirmerhorn Street and Joralemon Street, move them into Red Hook, further away from the subway, and the outcry. Does anybody remember when federal probation, or it might have been federal pretrial services, proposed to put their offices in the same building as I think it was St. Anne's? Does your kid go to St. Anne's?
No.
And the outcry. So I mean, you know, it gets a little bit to the issue of who we're talking about, and it gets to Neil's issue about the politics of it, right? I mean, society doesn't want this to happen, and I'm just not very optimistic that any serious politician is going to do what needs to be done, certainly at the local level, let alone at the national level. I'm very suspicious of Right on Crime. They just want less government, period.
Can you explain Right on Crime is the left-right
is the so-called the coalition of left and right, the ACLU and the Koch brothers, you know, singing Kumbaya, and you know, I guess to the extent that they move the game a little bit further towards reform, that's a good thing. But at the end of the day, I think that it's going to get to the issue of you know, they say, oh, well, we're going to get rid of the nonviolent, and it gets to Anne Marie's point that you can't do this without having a much broader definition of who we're going to welcome back into the fold of our community and how we're going to do that.
But I think that we could envision the notion of children who are in the jail. And I think to sort of Charles's point and the issue about raise the age, I think it's inhumane that children are in jail. I've over the 15 years that I've worked at cases met young people who were told in the jail that they had a mental illness. That's cruel. That is cruel. Do you know that they never were in the community? They weren't with a school counselor, but in a jail they were told, you have anxiety disorder, you have bipolar disorder. That is cruel. That's a kid in a jail without parents, caregivers, being made to make adult decisions about their care for something, you know, like being told you have liver cancer as a 17-year-old and what are you gonna decide in terms of your treatment? That is really cruel. You know it is, and I think that, again, it goes to the imagery, like the 17-year-old, 6'1" African-American boy doesn't look like a kid to us, but he is a kid, both developmentally and emotionally, and I don't know how we connect, but I could see something about the children children. I really, like, if we can't do anything about the children, that's just cruel. I just don't, I just can't live with that. I think that any young person, and I'm going to say under 21, who comes out of Rikers Island should have a crisis team talking to them, yes, so they can manage. Right. You know, they just should. We should. Our Health and Hospital Corporation, who now, as of January, is responsible for the care and treatment, because we got rid of Horizon, which is great, for-profit, GO, making money. You know, so there's something that we can do, and I think, like, just, like, and I'm not a child person, I respond to adults in the system, but I think that all of us can think about the children, and the children are people that are 20 and 17 and 18. Like, that, this is cruel. It really is inhumane, and it's very, very cruel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I think that for those who work on these issues, for those who care about these issues, and it's central to their efforts and their political view, to your point, Errol, I think that both kind of conversations can happen at the same point. I do think that we can continue to move, certainly on a local level, I'm more confident on a local level than on a national level, to enact the piecemeal reforms that we have to do because they affect people's lives, right? So getting 400 young people off of Rikers would be a mm-hmm. huge win that would have to be celebrated because it's a horrific stain on the city. And we would have to celebrate it even though it would continue to have 9,600 or so people mm-hmm. on the island, right? We have to continue to work to ban the box. We have to continue to work to return higher education and mental health supports in the system. I think we have to keep, as activists and organizers and policymakers, keep pushing the small advancements that will help small numbers of people because it's still the moral and just and ethical thing to do. That being said, I also think we have to, on a parallel level, have the macro conversation around the gross inequities that we're all talking about, the history of race and inequity within the country that continues to allow this to continue, right? This is a country that's always had policies in place that have monitored and controlled human bodies. It was slavery, then it was segregation interconnected with criminal systems, and now it is overwhelmingly the criminal justice system. But this is not new, it's always been in place. And so when we talk about the big business of prisons, we have to talk about that. People are making massive profit off of it. When we talk about the fact that it is a system that is rife with sickness and racism and classism, we have to talk about that. That doesn't mean we don't still end sexism and lots of issues that we have to continue to work on as the macro system efforts, right? I think we can do both at the same time. I don't think we can fool ourselves that any of these new efforts, exactly as you outlined and others, are really trying to change, though, the system writ large. Mm-hmm. And that's where I do think changing the conversation, changing the narrative, having people talk very directly about what this system looks like, what it does to America day in and day out, is something we have to continue to do. And that doesn't mean we don't keep pushing the smaller policy initiatives. But I have very little confidence that on a city or state level, we will see that kind of vision. I had no confidence that happened on a national level, because I don't think that, again, that's the population. You know, the last presidential election, you know, there was analysis done in the media, as you know better than anybody, Errol, that, you know, words poverty and poor were never even talked about. Forget people who are incarcerated. You know, we talk about the middle class and stop as if that's the kind of the bottom economic rung. But if we're talking about criminal justice systems, and if we, and it seems like we on the panel agree, that the system is completely rife with all the inequity we're talking about, then the central conversation today is about reform, right, or closing down Rikers. You can't reform something that sick, that's that much inequity, that's that much of a bigoted, vicious system. It has to be almost like crushed to the ground and reimagined of what you do for people.
You know what? Let's talk for a little bit about some of the reforms that are right in front of us. There's been quite a lot of discussion and some back and forth about proposals about who can visit Rikers Island, how long they can be in physical contact with someone there. There's been this whole question of people having to wear uniforms, which it caught me completely. It sort of blindsided me, and I never heard any kind of logical explanation about why that was considered a good thing. And of course, it's being implemented poorly, so now that becomes the discussion. What's some of the low-hanging fruit as far as the current discussion on the small-scale reforms?
I'll definitely touch base, especially in regards to the visitation part. So in regards like dealing with the entrenched culture of violence in Rikers, having those visitations is like sort of like a sanctuary to get yourself out of there for at least those 30 minutes, 45 minutes of visitation. And a matter of being able to sort of vision yourself outside of that situation. But once you put these try to minimize the minimum standard of visitation, which Commissioner Joseph Ponte has tried to do, which is make it extremely vague, as in like whoever's the visitor, if they have a conviction, they could limit, they could stop them from visiting them. If the person who is actually being held in Rikers has a prior conviction or their current charges, they could stop that person from getting visits, to someone just being a danger. So something sort of like if someone is sick, has like a cold, like a correctional officer that wants to be like, excuse my language, an asshole, could be like, this person could be a danger to like the rest of the people here. And that would be sufficient to take that person out. And we can't allow that, because those visitations are sort of like sanctuaries for the people there. And I know those visits that I have with my brother, with my mom, those helped me get through those days in Rikers. Mm-hmm. So we can't change that.
I really defer to the panel for specifics as to what is happening that's good on the island, but to speak to this point, because I know people who work on the island, and we talk to advocates all the time, it is mind-boggling to them that this administration, in an effort to reduce violence in Rikers, where they say much, much, much of the violence is from, or the contraband is coming from the guards, to impose these restrictions on families. You already have to take a day off from work because of all the convoluted ways to visit the island. To now make it more restrictive from this administration and from a corrections official who by all appearances is quite sympathetic with reform is kind of a head scratcher. It really is. I don't even know that there's a political value to it. It seems like just a mistake from what I'm hearing from advocates. I mean, I don't really have firsthand knowledge, but it's sort of a surprise, and it's certainly a setback. And we have people come through our offices all the time and say, and point to this policy. Is it implemented, or it's been proposed and approved by the Board of Corrections?
It's been proposed, and the Board of Corrections refused. They denied. They rejected it, but it's still up to like the commissioner and see what steps they're going to take.
Okay.
They're still considering it, and at least one member of the board is or was here today. So, he's still here.
I just kind of want to share from the perspective of visiting. I find it dehumanizing, and you know, I think it's different for men and women when you're asked to take off your brassiere, you're asked to take off your bra, and if you have something that they feel is see-through, you're then asked to go out and put on a jumpsuit that says visitor. And just the way in which you're treated, and you, regardless of your title, right, you're really stripped down of your humanity. And as family members who've gone to visit our loved ones or those that provide services, I just kind of feel like, you know, we need to do something different. And thank God for the programs like Friends Outside that could really work with us. But I know for myself, I've been going to prisons for close to, I'm 38 years old, close to 30 years on a work level 20, but just the fact that, you know, my family members and also those that I speak with, you know, having to travel long distance, not having the money to actually get a bus ticket or a train ticket, and then having to either, if you don't have your identification, which they've seen you every time that there's a visit, you can't get in. And so you're having to wait outside, and it's just really dehumanizing. And I just kind of feel like, you know, some of the small things, is making families feel comfortable when it's so uncomfortable to be there, and it's so traumatizing, and it's so hurtful to see a loved one on the other side. But I think it's just kind of like reevaluating the process in which families actually visit their loved ones.
And that's not just a matter of being nice. That's there's a public safety function to that as well, right? There's a payoff.
Yeah, you want to facilitate visits. And as I said, you know, the jail is such an unnatural world. I mean, think back to Glenn's story about having his jacket stolen, right? It's a world where we enforce scarcity. We put young men with lots of vitality who need to be active and insist that they be idle with, you know, no stimulation. There's no lending library in Rikers Island, right? There's no general reading library. There might be a book cart that goes around occasionally. There's no organized athletic activities, recreational activities, sports teams, and family is important. So why anybody would want to destroy that? I mean, it gets to the issue of why it would be a lot better and a lot easier if the jails weren't on Rikers Island. I mean, Rikers Island is sort of a symbol and it's a place. It's just an island, but if you think about it, it's a lot easier to visit somebody in Manhattan or in Brooklyn than it is to visit somebody on Rikers. We have to go through security twice, right? Once in the main visit house and then once again in the individual jail. So it gets to that whole argument. And you want to make it easier for families to visit. You want to have enough space that families can visit longer, right? Nobody should be asked to take off their brassiere. I mean, it's just absurd in this day and age to do business that way.
I can't follow the brassiere line. So I think earlier on it was said that our jail is part of the criminal justice system, and the solution to Rikers Island is actually at every interval of the criminal justice system, starting with NYPD and arrests, and then the court system and bail. I think that we should be touting all of the bail reforms. It seems to me, though, the first point about what do we arrest people for. So I think in New York, the highest crime that we still arrest people for is marijuana. It's not robbery, it's not assault, it's marijuana. So there's something there. And also about the different connections about sort of our probation department, our state parole department. A lot of folks are on Rikers Island who came out of our state prison system, not because they've committed a new crime, but because they didn't follow the rules of parole. Thousands of them, technical violators. Do you know, and it's like, you didn't go to treatment, you came late, all of that sort of stuff. So the notion of public safety, which is no new crimes, no new victims, is not even maybe realized by putting those folks, and Commissioner Horn knows about the sort of technical parole violators. And so I think it's important to think about all of the pieces, not just the jail. There's a whole sequence of things that happen from the person that we have seen in our program who was arrested on 125th Street in the path mark that's about to close, unfortunately, for stealing a banana that was processed through our criminal justice system and went to jail like Jerome Murdo. And so there's something in that sequence, and there are many reforms sort of happening both around bail, case processing, people with mental illnesses. And the question for all of us, I suppose, is it enough? Is it really gonna create the solution? One of the things that we've seen in other places around the country is you create diversion programs, you create alternatives to incarceration program, and they have no one single dent in a percentage decrease in the people in the jail. Which just, you know, and so there's something else about like having a real comprehensive response to who's in the jail and what they need to stay in the community safely so we're safe and they're safe and productive.
But I want to just mention, you know, one issue or attach comments to one of the issues you raised around this issue of marijuana, because I think it goes back to your question, Errol, about kind of where we could really see advancements. So just broad scopes of numbers. For about 20 years under the Koch administration, the Dinkins administration, and the beginning of the Giuliani administration, somewhere about 1,000 to 2,000 people were arrested a year for misdemeanor marijuana possession in the city of New York, 1,000 to 2,000. Over the 12 years of the Bloomberg administration, it spiked up to, at its height, 50,000 people a year, and its lowest number in the high 20s. So 27,000, 28,000 to 50,000 people a year for marijuana possession. 85% black and Latino. Once you have a marijuana possession record, misdemeanor, lots of things happen. There are permits you can't get inability to be a barber, inability to apply for financial aid. You can murder somebody, you can rape somebody and apply for financial aid. Certain levels of marijuana conviction, you can't apply for financial aid for college. You can't get into public housing, right? These are realities of the effect of it, okay? So the disparate enforcement on black and brown communities, we know pretty much every student at the new school has smoked weed, right? So we can just go arrest everybody here. Probably most of the professors as well. So it's gonna be a very low population at the new school if we enforce it, right? So you choose where you're gonna do this enforcement. And part of the problem with marijuana is there's often a lot of laughter about it. There's often a lot of, you know, of snickering about it, but there are cruel and harsh results around this disparate enforcement. And so you have an issue that was sending away 30 to 50,000 people around marijuana enforcement a year that was done by that administration. And you had the district attorney of Manhattan, Cy Vance, who went up to Albany to advocate for a change in the law so that you would not have this type of disparate enforcement. You had the district attorney of Brooklyn, Thompson, say he would not prosecute these cases anymore because there was so much racial inequity in how this law was enforced. And in the face of those two district attorneys, two of the highest law enforcement officials in the city and obviously highest profile in the country, that fell on deaf ears in Albany. They would not change the law. And so if you take something that can be so easily compartmentalized and the racially disparate enforcement so easily articulated and the mass numbers so easily shown, and you have DA Vance and DA Thompson saying this needs to be a change, and Albany refusing, or at least half of Albany, the Senate refusing to change the policy, it's an example of how difficult these conversations are once you get into the space of political will, because people either have an economic interest to the upstate prisons being still built and fueled by people from the city, or because people feel it will make them look, quote, soft on crime. And so you take an issue like that, and it can become very debilitating, I think, when you're moving on a policy level, Errol, because you say, if we can't get a win on that, with two district attorneys arguing that essentially the activist, the progressive, the social change movement is on the right side of this argument, it just is clear what kind of momentum you really need to build to establish any change.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We're getting to the point where we're gonna have you all join in with questions, and I was told that there'd be circulating microphones. Is that still right, Abigail?
Standing microphones.
Okay, so those who wanna ask, and I'll ask Glenn to come up. He's gonna help us moderate that next portion of this. I want to, before I take my leave, thank the panelists for a lively and informative discussion. I was trying to sort of take notes even while we were having the conversation. And I hope you all got as much out of it as I did in that some of the complexities of this, that what, you know, can be a simple hashtag, a simple slogan, a simple proposal, like shut down Rikers Island, which frankly I still think is worth talking about, is actually much broader, and we'll continue that discussion with some of your comments. Thank you.
Can we get just a round of applause for Errol Louis, please? Errol, when I said I was going to take your place, I meant on New York One.